Grace and peace to you in the name of Jesus Christ. I'm Reverend Cindy Carr, Senior Minister at First Congregational Church, Watertown, United Church of Christ. We are a congregation that welcomes people of diverse backgrounds, orientations, and faith experiences. So no matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, you are welcome with us here at First Church. This time for online worship is being brought to you by the deacons of the church as a way to stay connected in faith and to maintain a spiritual focus as we navigate this time of social distancing. As a congregation, we remain compliant with the Stay Home, Stay Safe directive, and we urge you to do the same. We expect to be worshiping online at least through June, but we're currently evaluating the best options to keep our community safe after that. Music for today's service is provided by our music director, Eric Trudell. We're so grateful for all he brings to our congregation. Our video production team, including camera operator Ian Pettigrew and editor and web designer Jim Gowell, have prepared the video. We thank them both for all their hard work and time. Today's message contains continues our lectionary readings from the Gospel of John. Jesus assures his disciples that even after he must leave them, they will not be left alone. They will be sent an advocate, meaning the Holy Spirit, to be with them. He also tells them if they love him, they will follow his commandments. We hope this online experience of worship inspires you to a deeper faith in God and in Jesus Christ. I love hearing from you about what moves you in worship. I really appreciate the feedback and the ideas. A few announcements before we start. Each week, I send out a message from the minister. It arrives by email or regular mail for those without email. There are church school activities available for the kids and weekly devotionals for the adults, all available by email, so you can call or email us at the church office if you'd like to receive these. Our deacons continue making calls and checking in with members and friends who are in need. We're working hard to reshape our outreach ministers in this time of social distancing. If there's something we can help you with, please contact the church and let us know. Remember to check your email and our church website each week for information and announcements. I do have one special announcement for today. Watertown Social Services has updated us on some of the needs for our community. Right now, they're asking people to purchase $10 gift cards for families in the community so that they can purchase exactly what they need. This time of pandemic has had serious economic impact on so many. Watertown's no exception. You may purchase gift cards at Adams, Stop and Shop, Dollar General, Watertown Meat Center, or Laban's. And you can bring them to Social Services at 61 Echo Lake Road in Watertown, or you can drop them into the church mailbox in the front door of Trumbull House, but we just ask that you call and let the office know that you're coming. So we begin today's worship in a time of prayer. Would you join me, please? God, we still our hearts. We do not know what words you will speak to us today, but we open ourselves to receive your truth. We want to see you, to know you more, and to receive your love by responding in worship. Our songs, our words, our actions are for you and you alone. Guide us, we pray, as we worship. Change us because we have been in your presence. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
As we gather in prayer, I ask you to keep in your prayers this week those who are ill with the COVID-19 virus, and those who are working so hard to care for them all, teachers, parents, and kids trying to make at-home learning a success, and those who are still fighting hard against other illnesses like cancer, heart disease, and diabetes. We also keep in our prayers those who are struggling with the downside of social distancing. Isolation and loneliness can be very difficult in these days. So please know that you are not alone. Let us be together in prayer. Eternal God, in whose presence we gather, in whose name we act and live, we offer up our prayers today. We give you thanks, O God, for this faith community, this part of the body of Christ at work in the world. We're thankful that in this uncertain time, where so many churches and businesses are struggling, we can still find ways to gather and feel your Holy Spirit, alive, vital, and hard at work within us. We pray that as a faith community, even during this time of pandemic, we're able to reach out beyond our homes into the community. So many are dealing with loss of jobs, economic and financial concerns, even struggling just to put food on their tables. Help us to remember others as we shop, to donate food, to send a meal, to connect in some small way, to show that Christ's love is alive in and through our community, and that those who struggle are not forgotten. We pray for churches and businesses, medical practices and schools, industry and retail, as we all navigate how and when we might reopen. We sit in a difficult place, needing to be apart so we stay healthy, and yet desperately needing the very businesses and economy that keep us going. Help us to find ways that don't pit our health against our money. Keep us working together, O God, finding ways to allay the anxiety that could push us in the wrong direction. For these and all things, we pray in the name of our crucified and risen Savior, Jesus Christ, who teaches us to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. God's love and hope are brought in many ways, not the least of which includes the outreach and ministries of our church. The hours that you give and the financial support made possible by your pledges and offerings help us to reach out in Christian love to those in need. Please remember to practice generosity in all its forms, especially during these days of social distancing. Continue checking on your elderly neighbors and friends and see what you can help, how you can help. If you can, please pick up the gift cards I mentioned in the announcements. You can do this while you shop, and it will greatly help others who are struggling. And remember your regular giving to the church, which supports all the ministries we do together. You can donate online or sign up for e-giving on our website, or you can mail in your regular pledges and offerings to the church office. Let us share generously for Christ's sake. For all we give and share and do for the sake of others, I offer this prayer of dedication today. Lord of all life, you have brought your word to us today, and you have called us to ministry and service. We ask now that you would dedicate our gifts and our lives to faithful actions through the Church of Jesus Christ. In his name we pray. Amen. Our first reading comes from the Psalms, the ancient hymn book of Israel, Psalm 66, verses 8 through 20. This psalm praises God for the many ways that he's blessed and brought goodness to Israel. The psalmist uses images like feet slipping, being tested, having burdens on our back, going through fire and water. These are images that speak of the hardship and difficulty that Israel has endured, having once been in captivity in Egypt and now being free. The psalmist declares that God has gotten them through it all, bringing them into a spacious place. I love that image, moving from a place that is burdensome and close to a place that is wide open, where you can breathe, you can stretch, and you can run free. The psalmist also makes it clear that gratitude and praise to God rise above any uncertainty and fear that we experience. And he praises God with his words and his actions. You'll hear him speak of the offerings that he will bring before God as a thanksgiving for God's presence in their lives. Today, as Christians, we don't make burnt offerings. We don't make blood sacrifices as they once did in ancient Israel. But we still offer God the praise of our lips and an offering of our lives in service to others, as Christ did. In either case, praise, action, and service are all part of an ongoing relationship with God, the God who does not abandon us. Hear these words. Bless our God, O peoples. Let the sound of his praise be heard, who has kept us among the living and does not let our feet slip. For you, O God, have tested us. You have tried us as silver is tried. You brought us into the net. You laid burdens on our backs. You let people ride over our heads. We went through fire and through water. Yet you have brought us out into a spacious place. I will come into your house with burnt offerings. I will pay you my vows, those that my lips uttered and my mouth promised when I was in trouble. I will offer to you burnt offerings of fatlings with the smoke of sacrifice of rams. I will make an offering of bulls and goats. Come and hear, all you who love God, and I will tell what he has done for me. I cried aloud to him, and he was extolled with my tongue. If I had cherished iniquity in my heart, the Lord would not have listened. But truly God has listened. He has given heed to the words of my prayer. Blessed be God, because he has not rejected my prayer or removed his steadfast love from me. Today's gospel lesson continues the farewell discourse that we heard last week. It's only days before Jesus is to be crucified, and he's giving instructions and saying goodbye to his disciples. In this portion of the gospel, Jesus promises them that he will not leave them alone, and that God will send another advocate or counselor, meaning the Holy Spirit, to guide them as they continue their ministry. But he also puts their future ministry into a context that cannot be ignored. He tells them, "Keep my commandments." By doing this, they show their love and strengthen their relationship with him and also with God. By doing this, they also show the world who they are and what they stand for. Now, typically, we read little sections of scripture each week, and they're not really meant to be heard in isolation. They're meant to be heard one after the other in context. And today's passage about keeping the commandments is meant to be heard right on the heels of what Jesus says in chapter 13. I give you a new commandment, that you love one another. Just as I have loved you, you should also love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another. So this new commandment does not really supersede the other commandments that they're to keep. It really sums them all up. They're to do everything because they love God, and they are to share God's love with others. So hear these words from the Gospel of John. If you have love, you will keep my commandments. And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to be with you forever. This is the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it neither sees him nor knows him. You know him, because he abides in you, and he will abide, and he will be in you. I will not leave you orphaned. I am coming to you. In a little while, the world will no longer see me, but you will see me. Because I live, you will also live. On that day, you will know that I am in my Father, and you in me, and I in you. They who have my commandments and keep them are those who love me, and those who love me will be loved by the Father, and I will love them and reveal myself to them. May God's blessing be added to our hearing and understanding of these holy words. I must be getting old. My perspective on things has changed over the years. I've learned hard lessons and dealt with loss. Like many people, I see greater depth and I'm less anxious than I used to be. And I appreciate certain things in life so much more now. I've learned to let go of stuff that ultimately doesn't matter. One of the areas where this is evident is when I'm working with couples preparing for a wedding. While their parents and grandparents may pine that these kids don't know what real love is, or they get upset when the kids set up housekeeping way too soon for real love to grow, I see many advantages to a couple spending time together to get to know each other in all kinds of ways before they make the big commitment. It doesn't really cheapen marriage. It may actually give it a better fighting chance. But what I still bristle at is the way that those who are young and in love sometimes still fall prey to the many myths we have about what love is and how love feels. Here are some of the ones you probably know. If you can't feel love for your partner, then you don't really love him or her. We never fight because we love each other so much. Don't worry, you'll know when it's the real thing. Your partner should complete you and make you feel whole. Head over heels love or love at first sight is a real thing. 50-year marriages are built on it. To make these myths seem credible, our movie industry is filled with heart-wrenching portrayals of these ideals, making it so easy to doubt if your relationship has any merit or is the real deal. Real love, in all its forms, isn't just a feeling. It's also a verb. Love in action. Love in service. Love that persists in all the places in life, even those that get ugly, hard, and exhausting. Love isn't heart shapes and wine and chocolate. Sometimes it's picking up a shovel, making a meal, changing diapers, sharing the remote, or even vacuuming. When love is a feeling, it's about the two of you in a bubble striving against the world. It's disconnected from the brain, the soul, the family, and the community. When love is a verb, it is intimately connected to things like common sense, real-world consequences, our relationship with God, and with all the people who care for us and that we care for. When love is a feeling, ultimately the question becomes, does she love me? Does he love me? You remember the daisy where you pull the petals off, she loves me, she loves me not. That question is focused on the self, and it's based in a certain anxiety about being loved and what the other is doing for us. When love is a verb, ultimately the question becomes, what do you need to become more whole, to be who you are meant to be, and how can I help you to achieve this? When love is a feeling, it can turn on a dime and become things like hate, envy, jealousy, revenge, and denial. People can be moved to do terrible things when love doesn't turn out or feel like they expected it would. When love is a verb, we seek the best for the other, for our community, for the world, and we are happy to cooperate in making that happen. When love is a feeling, there might be a powerful motivation to try to recreate someone into a person that they are not, or are not happy being. The question becomes, who do I need you to be for me? Or even, how can I train you to do what I want? When love is a verb, we first work on ourselves to be the best we can be. And we find ways to achieve our own sense of fulfillment, to meet our own needs, and then to offer and seek out ways to help others fulfill theirs. There's so much more, but you get the idea. Well-known author Scott Peck once wrote, Love is the will to extend one's life for the purpose of nurturing one's own or another's spiritual growth. Love is as love does. Love is an act of will, namely both an intention and an action. Will also implies choice. We do not have to love, we choose to love. Peck also wrote this: genuine love is volitional rather than emotional. The person who truly loves does so because of a decision to love. This person has made a commitment to be loving whether or not the loving feeling is present. Conversely, it is not only possible but necessary for a loving person to avoid acting on feelings of love. Love, as a verb, requires an act of the will, a decision to care for another, an awareness of our community and our place in it. The truth is that it's natural to fall out of love the same way we fall in love. It's natural for that magic or that chemistry to wane over time. But this occurrence is often a missed opportunity to learn to truly love the other in deeper, more meaningful, and more powerful ways. Once we fall out of love, we then have an opportunity to truly love the other, warts and all, dirty laundry and all, failures, successes, imperfections, and stellar qualities, all. But it takes a more mature person, a more secure person, a person with the capacity to look beyond the self in order to truly love. Here are some examples of real love in action. Working as a team to raise a grandchild unexpectedly. Sticking with your partner day after day after day as he or she battles dementia, remembering for him or for her your whole life together. Working through financial devastation together, sick kids or the loss of a job, the loss of a home. Giving each other the space you need to explore what feeds you individually and making sacrifices for each other. Taking your mother or your father-in-law out for the day so your partner can have some time for respite. Now, there aren't any romantic movies about this kind of love. It's not glamorous. It's deeper, harder, and longer lasting. It's also sacrificial. Jesus speaks about love often. He uses love verbs 57 times in the Gospel of John alone. He speaks about agape love, that's God's love for us and selfless love for others, and philia, love for a friend. The Gospel of John is remembered best for the verse, chapter 3, verse 16, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, so that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life." For the Gospel of John, the good news is all about love. God's love for us, Jesus's love for us and for God, our love for God through Jesus. In today's scripture passage, we are promised that we will not be left alone to minister and love the world, but that we will be given an advocate, the Holy Spirit, to guide and console us. We are commanded to love as Jesus loves, to love one another lovingly. But take note, here, love is action, not a feeling. Jesus doesn't tell us to wait until we feel good about the other, but to act for the sake of another. And this is exactly the kind of love that is needed, not only in the context of a marriage or partnership, but anywhere we operate in the world. Perhaps that means dealing with neighbors, interacting with coworkers or friends at school, or even wearing your mask when we go to the store. Love isn't about how we feel, it's about what we do. To obey Jesus' commandments is not so much about towing the line as a burden, but about centering our lives, our energy, and our attention toward Jesus' commandments. To follow Jesus, to obey his commandments, requires work, self-sacrifice at times, and the ability to look beyond our own needs. It's love with a much bigger picture in mind. In these days of struggle and fear, as we continue to figure out what social distancing means now and will mean moving forward, as we deal with things like pandemic brain fog, fatigue, and an urgency to deal with the economic fallout of it all, my prayer is that those who follow Jesus will remember the nature of God's love that we are asked to share with others. Not just those we meet in the store who might be anxious about germs and lines, not just those who are trying to lead us through difficult decisions, but even those who are closest to us, those we live with, those we talk to on a daily basis. These are the days when romantic love is sorely tested and will not be enough. These are the days when learning to love as Jesus loves, in deeper ways, more powerful ways, Spirit-filled ways, will bring us through. And we will be able to open our mouths in praise to the God who has not abandoned us, but who brings us out into a spacious place. Thanks be to God. Amen. As we conclude our time of worship today, receive this blessing. May the angels of heaven be among us. May we have an abundance of peace. May our vessels be full of charity. May our banks be rich with mercy. May cheerfulness preside over us. And in all things, may Jesus Christ be present. Amen.